शाह एंड सीए रवि शुशा, चेयरमैन ऑफ अहमदाबाद ब्रांच सीए हरित दारीवाल, सीनियर मेंबर्स एंड माय डियर फ्रेंड्स, वेलकम टू दिस वैल्यूएशन सेशन. इट इज सेड दैट वैल्यूएशन इज एन आर्ट एज वेल एज अ साइंस. एज एन आर्ट, वैल्यूएशन इन्वॉल्व्स डिटरमाइनिंग वेरियस फैक्टर्स सच एज इकोनॉमिक आउटलुक, सेल्स फैक्टर, डिटर्मिनेशन ऑफ द डिस्काउंट रेट, वेर एज साइंस इन्वॉल्व्स द वेरियस वैल्यूएशन अप्रोच. So a very warm welcome to these two sessions which focuses on the market approach as well as the income approach. So let's begin the session with ICI motto. Request everyone to put their hand on their heart for the motto.
तेषु जाग्रति कामं 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 कामंशो पुरुषो निर्मिमाणः निर्मिमाणः तदेव शुक्रं तदेव शुक्रद्ब्रह्म तद्ब्रह्म तदेवामृतमुच्यते
Thank you, Shehzad Bhai. Request Chairman of Ahmedabad Branch, C. Harit Dhariwal, to give opening remarks.
Thank you, Anjali Ben. So, faculty for the session, C. Bhakti Shah and Revushu Shah from Mumbai, the Secretary of the Branch, C. Anjali Ben Choksi, all the esteemed members who have joined us for this wonderful session on valuation. Very good evening to all of you. Friends, a very, very important topic chosen at a very right time. My full credit goes to Anjali Ben for organizing this wonderful session. And I was just going through the details of the session wherein you'll be discussing upon something on the overview of valuation, the market approach, the DCF valuation, which is so much so important. So it's a wonderful area of practice. We are also going to have a lot of sessions on the new and emerging areas of practice, and valuation is one of them. So it's good that you have started it, Anjali Ben, right now. And going forward, we are going to have many more sessions on valuation as well. Before I hand over to the faculty, I would also want to mention a few events from the branch that are coming up at Ahmedabad branch. First and foremost, tomorrow we have a very interesting session on GST on the internal auditor's perspective. So we have always known GST as far as the compliance is concerned. This time we are specifically dealing with issues that, you know, as an internal auditor should also consider as far as the GST is concerned. So very interesting session tomorrow evening by Dr. CA Puneet Agarwal from Delhi. He's going to join us virtually. On Saturday, we have again two important sessions, one on the critical aspects of the budget 2021, now Finance Act 2021. So what has happened is there are so many issues which have, you know, basically not been discussed, because when we talk about budget or any finance act, the major issues that are impacting everybody gets covered. But this time we have, you know, unearthed so many issues which have not been discussed frequently. Hence, we have kept a specific session on the critical aspects of Finance Act 2021. In which even specific emphasis will be given to the NR taxation, because that has had a major impact in this budget. Another session on that day is again a very important, again an emerging area of practice, I should say, a faces assessment. Because as young practitioners, it is very important for us to be, you know, very good at drafting, very good at presentation. So this specific section on faces assessment will tell you how the next phase of assessment are going to happen. Plus, they will be having a specific focus on drafting. So please attend. CA Namrata Dedia from Mumbai will be joining for that session. And for the budget finance act session, Soumya Seth from Ahmedabad will be joining on that. And apart from that, I think Movement 73, we all are aware, is going on. We have had three wonderful days on that movement and everybody is enjoying that. So those who are yet to register, I would even urge the faculties from Mumbai to register for this movement and take advantage of it. Ma'am, it's one of its kind fitness event that has never happened in the country. So we are doing it for the first time. And we have more than 1900 participants from across the country. Few even overseas were participating in that. It's a virtually organized fitness carnival. The registrations are still on. So I would urge all the members to take benefit of it. If you have any queries, any doubts, Anjali Ben is here. And we all are there at branch. We all can help you sort it out. So thank you once again. And once again, I welcome Bhakti Ben for this session. Over to you, Anjali Ben.
Thank you, Chairman, for the important updates and guidance. Yes, Movement 73 has now become a national movement, and we would be requesting all our faculties as well as the remaining members who are still not registered. It is going to be a really a national movement. So taking the session ahead, I'm first of all very thankful to CA Bhakti Shah and CA Ravishu Shah for their prompt acceptance, and especially Bhakti ma'am for designing this series. We had a lot of conversation what to include, what to not to include, because valuation is a big thing. So thank you, Bhakti ma'am. And now I would request coordinator CA Samir Chaudhary to introduce the first faculty for today, CA Bhakti Shah.
Thank you, Anjali Ben and Harish ji. Bhakti Shah, partner at SSPA and company, is a chartered accountant with post-qualification experience of about 20 years. She is a registered valuer under Companies Act 2013. Bhakti specializes in valuation for business, securities, and intangibles for mergers and acquisitions, Ind AS reporting and regulatory requirements, and also provides corporate restructuring advisory services. Prior to joining SSPA in 2009, she has worked with PricewaterhouseCoopers and NM Raji & Company. She has actively participated in the ICAI Valuation Standard Committee for formulation of ICAI Valuation Standards issued by ICAI. She has co-authored CITC publication Handbook on Valuation. With this great introduction, I welcome you, ma'am.
Thank you, Harit. Thank you, Samir and Anjali. Thank you for inviting me to host this session, which is an important topic in recent times. I will share the presentation. Is the screen visible?
Yes.
Yes.
Good evening, everyone. So today's topic, as Anjali and I had a couple of discussions as to what we should cover and what will interest the participants more. So we have, we have tried to be very specific as to what we want to cover in today's session. As everyone is aware that in recent times, valuers have come into limelight because of the introduction of the company's registered valuers and valuation rules, which was notified by MCA in October 2017 under the Section 247 of the Companies Act. Now, these provisions were introduced with the objective to ensure that the valuers are independent, they are bias-free, they carry out the valuation diligently, and give a true and fair view on the valuation of the assets. Section 247 of the Companies Act, it provides that any valuation that is required under the Companies Act needs to be carried out by a registered valuer. This registered valuer needs to be appointed by the board of directors or the audit committee of the company. There are certain penal provisions also which has been introduced in the Companies Act, whereby in case a valuer contravenes the provisions of this act with an intention to defraud the company or its shareholders, he will be penalized. Now, there are various Indian regulations which require valuations to be carried out. However, till date, I think so, except Companies Act, Insolvency and Bankruptcy Code, and SEBI to some extent. Other regulations have still not included this requirement of valuation to be necessarily carried out by a registered valuer, which means that under those acts or regulations, the valuation can be carried out by a chartered accountant or a merchant banker or any professional agency that has been specifically written in those regulations. Coming to the registered valuer rules, these rules have been introduced, and it contains an entire gamut of provisions which deals with the eligibility and the registration of the registered valuers, the authority that will govern the valuers, what are the valuation standards that the registered valuer should follow, the code of conduct, and also the contents of the report which a valuer needs to consider. The registered valuer needs to register with IBBI, which is the authority which has been appointed by the central government to ensure the compliances with these regulations. Now, the registered valuer has to register for one or all the asset classes with IBBI. There are three asset classes which have been introduced till date: land and building, plant and machinery, and securities and financial assets. Now, one needs to be very careful that a registered valuer, if he has, say, registered only for one asset class, for example, securities and financial assets, he cannot carry out valuation for land and building and plant and machinery. Also, the registered valuer is required to register with a RVO. RVO is Registered Valuer Organization, which in turn needs to register with IBBI. The RVO has been given the responsibility to regulate the valuers and to also impart regular training to these valuers. Under these rules, the registered valuer needs to adopt the valuation standards which are notified by the central government while carrying out the valuation. However, till date, there are no valuation standards notified by central government, and therefore the registered valuer needs to carry out the valuation either as per internationally accepted valuation standards or valuation standards which have been adopted by a RVO. With a need for standardizing the practices, the procedures, and the principles which are involved in a valuation process, the Institute of Chartered Accountants of India has notified ICAI Valuation Standards 2018, which have been adopted by the ICAI RVO as well. Now, these standards, there are some 8 standards which have been notified till date, out of which 5 are general standards laying down basic principles, methodologies of valuation. And there are 3 specific asset standards on business valuation, intangible assets, and financial instruments. Last year, Valuers Bill 2020 was introduced. It is still awaiting the Parliament's approval. This bill provides for establishment of an institute which in turn will regulate the valuers and also for the development of the valuers profession and to protect the interest of the users of a valuation. It seems that once this valuers bill is adopted by the Parliament and approved, maybe the earlier registered valuer rules will no longer be applicable, but we yet need to see when this will get approved. Moving to what is value. Sometimes value and price are used interchangeably. However, there is a fine line of difference between the two. Value is what you get, whereas price is what you pay. Price is a result of a negotiation between a willing buyer and a willing seller. When a person comes to a valuer for valuation, say a seller or a buyer comes to a valuer for a valuation, the value which a valuer provides is generally the price, minimum price which a seller will get and the maximum price which a buyer should pay. There are various synonyms of value in market. Market value, fair value, realizable value, liquidation value, value in use, relative value. Now, each of these terms are actually standards or basis of value, and they should be used depending upon the purpose of valuation. So, for example, if you are doing a valuation for the purpose of, say, merger or demerger, where you need to recommend a share exchange ratio, then the relative value is relevant. If you are doing, say, for financial reporting, whereby you need to do the impairment of assets or a financial report or for fair value of investments, then a fair value or a value in use is what is relevant. Say, if you are doing a valuation for an insolvency case under IBC, then a liquidation value will become relevant. Now, the second thing which is very critical is valuation is entity specific. It is for a specific purpose and it is date specific. If any of this one factor changes, the valuation may not hold good. So let's take an example. A valuation which is done, say, last month, in March, and if there is a change in the government policy, so there's a valuation done for a telecom company and the government comes down with a change in the telecom policy, whereby the valuation which was done last month may not hold true today. Now coming to the purpose, say you are doing a valuation for a minority shareholder, and if you're doing a valuation for acquiring a controlling stake in a company, both these valuations could be different because in case of a minority interest, you may have to apply some discount. Whereas when you want to do a valuation for acquiring a controlling stake, there could be a control premium which will come into play. Then it comes to valuation is entity specific. Why so? Say if I am doing a valuation for a strategic investor, he may want to understand the value of the target company after including the synergy pricing in it. Whereas if I'm doing a valuation for a financial investor, he is just looking at a particular return which he may earn on an investment. Now, while valuation looks like a mathematical formula, in reality, it's not just a mathematical formula. If you hire, say, 5 valuers to value an asset, all the valuers may ascribe a different value to the same asset. It is because it involves a use of judgment. Therefore, one should always keep in mind that valuation is an expression of opinion. It's not a certification on the value. And therefore, valuation is subjective. Now, what are the needs why a valuation is called for? There are different reasons why a valuation will be called for. One is for, say, restructuring like merger, demerger, purchase and sale of shares of business. In case of litigations or dispute resolution, the court may direct that a valuation needs to be carried out by a valuer. In case of family settlement, in case of obviously financial reporting, purchase price allocation, and lastly, the regulatory requirements. Now, what are the steps that are involved in a valuation process? The first and foremost step in valuation is that the valuer needs to understand the purpose of valuation, and then he needs to adopt an appropriate basis of value and the premise of value. The second step will be to obtain information. Now, what are the information which is critical for any valuation exercise? One is your historical information. Secondly, one should know the industry overview, understand the business overview of the subject company being valued, future projections, look at the stock prices and the stock exchange announcement in case of a listed company, look at the listed comparable companies, study on the listed comparable companies. Newspaper reports is also a critical source of information, market research, analyst reports. And this will help you to give you a basic understanding on the company. After this, there one needs to analyze that information. One needs to have discussions with the management of the company in case there are any issues or any clarifications required, or there's a better understanding of business required. Now, while the discussions of management, one should keep in mind that it should not be restricted just to the finance team. One should also interact with the operating and the marketing team of the company to have a better understanding of the business. Based on the analysis, if you feel that there are certain events which have occurred, one may in the company, which are one-time, non-recurring, then one may need to look at adjusting the past information.
Of the day, any DCF will depend in terms of the two assumptions. And as I mentioned, the cash flows and the discount rate. How do you analyze the cash flows? So if the cash flow, many a times when we receive projections from the client, they will have either a positive bias or a negative bias. Depending on the motivation which is there for giving the projections. So it could be optimistic or it could be over optimistic, or sometimes it could be pessimistic. So what usually we do is look at the historical performance versus the projected performance. Also do the macroeconomic analysis in the business environment analysis. How the peers have been growing over a period of time. What are the peer companies in the businesses? How have our subject company perform vis-a-vis the peer companies and vis-a-vis the industry growth? Are there any macroeconomic factors which will guide the future growth of the business significantly? So to give you an example, an automotive company, we were doing a valuation of an automotive company which had a very significant market share, catering to a two-wheeler market. Almost a market share of 60%, 70%, and consistently a 60-70% of a market share. Almost like a monopoly sort of a product catering to multiple OEMs. And it was going through a transitioning period because the product which it was manufacturing will have to be entirely overhauled on the changing of the fuel guidelines from Bharat 5 to Bharat 6 going forward. And the entire product has to be redesigned and recalibrated to meet the newer requirements. So these are the things which we need to keep in the back of our mind. Are there any specific industry trend or any industry specific factors? More importantly, are there any regulatory factors? Are there any, let's say like a customs duty? So if you are doing a valuation of a steel company, are there any anti-dumping duties which is helping me currently? If anti-dumping duty is helping me currently because of the prices, I mean, how long will it sustain? Will it be there for the eternity? I mean, those are the questions one has to think through. How is the quality of the management? And this is both at the operating level or and both at the board level in terms of the corporate governance. Analysis of historical deviations between budget and actuals. So where the company periodically makes the budget on an annual basis, it's also good to analyze what has been the historical deviations between the budget and the actuals. It gives us a flavor of how robust the company's budgeting system is, and typically what sort of a deviations historically has been vis-a-vis the budgets. Another important aspect is the capital expenditure. I mean, is the capital expenditure which has been forecasted, is it adequate for growth and the maintenance? This typically will require an analysis of, let's say, the life of the assets, economic life of the asset. What is an asset turnover ratio? Is the asset turnover ratio significantly increasing over the projection period? Is it in line with the peer companies? What are the working capital requirements in the business? Are there any seasonality? Typically, in certain cases, like an agrochemical industry or an industry which is focusing on the agriculture commodities, usually you see a working capital cyclical nature in the business. So it is also important to understand what is an average working capital requirement over a year, rather than the point in time working capital requirement. Because point in time working capital requirement could be a distorting requirement. So we were doing a valuation of an oil company which was manufacturing the oil, and it had a working capital cycle which was very, very seasonal in nature. So at the year end, it used to have a very, very significantly low working capital because the cycle will close in terms of the inventory and the receivable realization. And if I were to look at somewhere in the middle of the year, it would reach a significant peak. So in those cases, you need to be sure in terms of what is an average working capital requirement. In such a kind of a business, we also try and see what is a month-on-month or a quarter-on-quarter working capital requirement for a better analysis. Another question which is often posed to us as a valuer is, what should be the valuation method? Should it be free cash flow to firm? Should it be free cash flow to equity? And does it matter? Or should it give you the same answer at conceptually? So while conceptually, whether you do an FCFF or FCFE, it should give you a similar answer. More often than not, there are significantly practical difficulties in their reconciliation. From an operational perspective, if I were to look at it, my personal preference, I would prefer to do FCFF for most of the asset other than FCFE. FCFE, typically I'll do it for companies which are more dependent on the fund as a business. So let's say if we were to do a valuation of something like an NBFC. NBFC, typically one will do a valuation through a price to book multiple. But let's say if somebody was to also give a projections or something like a service industry. In those cases, one can try and use the FCFE. But something which is an asset heavy, the preference is to do FCFF rather than FCFE. And as I said, I mean, it's a personal preference. It's slightly better to the from an overall perspective. Typically the question which comes in FCFE is what should be a discount rate, and many a times in case of any of the projects or the business, the borrowing requirement changes materially over a period of time. and how would one adjust the borrowing, I mean the changes in the leverage to the cost of equity over a period of time, often is a question mark for an FCFE. Terminal value computation, this is once again one of the most important part of any DCF. Many a times terminal value account for maybe something like a 70% 80% of the overall value. I mean that's the chunk of which is dependent on the terminal value computation. How should one compute the terminal value? More often than not, in normal cases one looks at a Gordon growth model, which assumes a constant growth beyond the explicit period. In certain cases where the business has not reached a steady state of a growth at the end of the explicit period, and you believe that there could be more growth before it reached maybe a stabilized level of a growth, one can also use a three-stage or a variable stage model, which is like extending the explicit period and tapering down the growth to a moderate level of a normalized level of a growth over maybe another 3 years or 5 years. Certain people also used the exit multiple. Exit multiple is something like what should be an EBITDA multiple at the time of the exit. Usually, when you do the valuation or when a private equity or a venture capital does valuation, quite often they look at the exit multiples. Which is what would be the exit multiple when they are planning to have an exit from the business. That's how they usually do the valuation. Salvage value, liquidation value. This is usually used for the businesses which have a definitive life. Let's say I'm operating a single power plant, not a platform of a power plant, but a single power plant. Which has a residual life of another 10 years or 20 years. At the end of 10 years or 20 years, which is the end of the economic life, I will still realize the salvage value by selling or the scrap sale of the physical assets, liquidation of the land and other assets which are there in the business. In those cases, salvage value or liquidation value is taken into account. Terminal value growth rate, terminal growth rate. So terminal growth rate depends in terms of what is the level of operations or a growth expected beyond the explicit period. What is the capacity utilization at the end of the explicit period? Has it reached the optimum level of a capacity utilization? If it has not reached the optimum level of capacity utilization, you may still wish to do some sort of a multi-period growth model. What is the market share at the end of the period? Many a times where a company is dependent on a single product or a couple of products, what is typically a product life cycle? Is the life cycle of the product likely to come to an end rather than a renew? Then you may have a different view on the expected growth. What is the life of the asset or the residual life of the asset after the explicit growth period? Once again, it goes into the definite, does it have a definitive life or an indefinite life? Capital expenditure, which is required to support the growth and similar factors. Cyclical assets, typically one will do the terminal value computation taking into account the entire cycle rather than looking at the top of the cycle or at the bottom of the cycle. Another important aspect from a DCF is also the treatment of the tax. What do we do for the carry forward losses? What do we do for the tax holiday? What happens if there is a MAT which is MAT credit which is available to us at the end of the period or during the explicit period or something which is available to me on day zero? In any DCF, what usually we do is to do the computation of a tax on a detailed basis, which takes into account if there are any residual tax holiday period. Your cash flows should take into account those residual tax period, residual tax holiday period. In case if any MAT credit is available to us at the beginning of the period, or we are expected to pay MAT during the explicit period and use it thereafter, those consideration also has to be taken into account. Sometimes at the end of the explicit period, you still have certain tax losses which are available, or a tax holiday period which is available, or a MAT credit which is available and remaining unutilized. How do you treat those elements? Typically, we do a present value of those benefit and add it separately for doing a terminal value computation. So if there is an unabsorbed MAT credit available to us at the end of the explicit period, we will try and see over what duration it is expected to be utilized, take a present value of it and add it separately. For terminal value computation, usually one will use a marginal growth rate rather than any further benefit in the terminal value computation. So in a sense, the deferred tax adjustment is usually not taken into account, because the actual cash flows, which takes into account the reversal of the deferred tax or the adjustment on account of the deferred tax, is taken into account. So present value of tax holiday benefit at the end of the explicit period is added separately. Any questions?
Sir, we can take the sessions at the end.
Okay, fair. Discount rate estimation. How do we estimate a discount rate for a DCF method? There are different methods in terms of doing a discount rate computation. And what is a discount rate? Discount rate is an expectation of a market participant of the risk which is inherent in the subject asset. So it's a market participant's expectation. So let's say if I am an investor, and looking at investing in a particular asset, should it make a difference of what my cost of capital is, or it should matter what is the risk which is inherent in the underlying asset? Should the discount rate be different for a Japanese investor, where the risk-free rate would be significantly lower, as compared to an Indian investor where the risk-free rate is still significantly higher? Answer typically is no, because the risk is dependent on the underlying asset and not the investor. So if a Japanese investor is investing in an Indian asset, or whether a US investor is investing in an Indian asset, it should typically have a similar level of a discounting rate, rather than using a differential discounting rate for a different participant. If you are trying to use a different discounting rate, which is basically the hurdle rate of your client, it usually is a participant specific value, and it may or may not be a fair value. So let's say if a cost of capital of a business is, let's say, 13%, but if I am evaluating a proposal from my side and I say, for me, hurdle rate is 15%, and I would wish to use a hurdle rate of 15% for doing my assessment. That is a participant specific value or an investor specific value rather than a fair value, because a fair value will be guided by what is the cost of capital, which is inherent or which is dependent on the risk of a business, rather than the what would be the different level of an expectation for a wider of a particular investor. A particular investor may have a high return expectations or may have a low return expectations. But at the end of the day, you are looking at a market participants at a large rather than an investor in isolation. Typically, we use the cost of equity, capital asset pricing model for determining the cost of equity. And it usually is used when you are doing a free cash flow to equity. Cost of equity is also a component for doing a weighted average cost of capital, and obviously which is typically when you do the free cash flow to firm. When you do a valuation of a liability, let's say sometimes we are required to do the valuation of a debenture or a non-convertible debenture, or valuation of a loan, In those cases, cost of debt is more appropriate discounting rate instead of cost of equity or a weighted average cost of capital. And when you are estimating what is the cost of a debt, you would take into account any default risk and so on. Yield, once again, these are the things which are used for a bond or debenture. So when you are doing a valuation of a bond or a debenture, typically what you see is what's a yield to maturity on those cases, or yield to call or yield to put, and try to do a valuation of bond or the underlying debentures. As I mentioned, capital asset and the weighted, I mean, is usually the most commonly used the approach for determining the cost of equity. Build-up method is used when the market inputs are not available. So when you are doing a valuation for, let's say, some of the countries where you don't necessarily have a deep market or a deep equity market, some of the African countries, over there you may wish to use built-up method. But in most cases where you are doing a valuation for the developing economies, or maybe the reasonably developing economies or the developed economies, people usually use the capital asset pricing model for determining the both the cost of equity and the WACC. What are the components of a capital asset pricing model? It starts with risk-free rate, and a beta into the equity risk premium, plus an alpha, and we'll go into the individual component of it. What is RF? RF is typically the risk-free return in respect of a security which has no default risk. From an Indian context, what we usually use is the yield on the 10-year government security. Any specific reason why we use a 10-year government security? Can we use 5-year? Can we use 20 years? The reason for using a 10-year government security is typically it's the most liquid security which is available. Liquidity is an important criteria to assess whether the market is pricing a security appropriately or not. So 10-year is the most liquid security typically in the Indian context, and it is also sufficiently long for a business which is expected to go in perpetuity. So we had come across a valuation of, let's say, a concession agreement which had a residual life of 3 years or 5 years. Where the business has a residual life of 3 years or 5 years, can I use a shorter term government security risk? Yes, certainly I can use that. So, but barring those exceptional cases, in normal cases, the tendency is to use 10-year government security. Preferably use a zero coupon yield curve. What is a zero coupon yield curve? Zero coupon yield curve is currently there are no zero coupon 10-year government securities in the Indian market. Why do we need to use a zero coupon security? Is in case of an interest bearing security, you always have a reinvestment risk. So let's say the security is paying a 7% of a coupon every year. When the cash flow comes to me as a holder of the instrument, does it mean that I'll be able to reinvest that cash flows at the 7% every year? Answer is no, because the reinvestment of that particular coupon will depend on what are the interest rates which are prevailing at that point in time. So even in case of a coupon bearing instrument, I as a holder of the instrument has a reinvestment risk. In case of a zero coupon, there is no reinvestment risk because there are no coupon which is there during the horizon, during the holding period. This is typically what we get. FIMDA provides the zero coupon yield curve. CCIL also provides, and CCIL is available, I think, publicly available. There's no subscription required. So one can use that. Equity risk premium. This is often a concept, and a lot of subjectivity is involved in terms of what should be an appropriate level of an equity risk premium. And the other is, should there be any equity risk premium? Let's say if I'm holding a debenture, or let's say if I'm holding a government security for last 10 years. and if I'm investing in equity market, usually if I were to look at it on a longer period, the return on the equity market always are higher as compared to the return on the government securities. Then does it call for any risk? Why there should be an equity risk premium? The reason is that the equity markets are volatile. Equity markets are volatile in the sense that while over a longer period, the equity market returns definitely will be higher as compared to the returns which you get in a government securities market. But equity markets are significantly volatile. And why it calls for an equity risk premium is because of the volatility in the equity market vis-a-vis the risk-free rate, or vis-a-vis the government security market. Should it depend in terms of the historical returns of the equity markets vis-a-vis the government security market, or should it be dependent on the expectation? Any valuation has to depend on the expectations rather than how has been the historical performance. But the problem with that is that the expectations are not visible. I mean, are there any periodical surveys which are available in the market where you go and do the analysis? More often than not, the answer is no, as far as India is concerned. So typically what we see is people try and rely on the historical risk, historical returns from the market, have some sort of a subjective assessment whether this is a reasonable number or otherwise, and proceed with that. Currently most of the people use anything between 7% to 8% for the India market as the equity risk premium. What is a beta? Beta is a measure of volatility or a systematic risk of a particular security vis-a-vis market as a whole. Now we define the equity risk premium, or the reason for the equity risk premium is the volatility. Now, if the volatility is higher, should my return expectation be higher? Answer is yes. And on the converse, if the volatility is lower, should my return expectation should be lower? Answer once again should be yes. So when I look at a return expectation from, let's say, a utility company, or let's say a power generation company, or let's say a pharmaceutical company or an FMCG company, should it be different as compared to what my return expectation from a real estate sector or from an entertainment sector? Answer is certainly yes. And the reason for that is that the beta or the volatility of the pharmaceutical stock or the volatility of the utility stock is significantly lower as compared to the volatility in the real estate market. And if the volatility is high, I as an investor would seek a higher returns because I am carrying a higher risk because of the volatility. What should be the another question which is often asked is what should be the periodicity of a beta? Should I look at a single company? If my company is itself a listed company, should I consider the beta of my company? Should I look at a beta of peer set, or should I look at wider sector specific beta? Another question is, what should be the time frame for beta? Should it be 1 year? Should it be 6 months? Should it be 5 years? Computed on a daily basis or a weekly basis or a monthly basis? So usually what we try and see is beta depends in terms of the volatility. And for volatility to be reflected in a realistic manner, there has to be a sufficient volume in the stock. So if a stock is not traded, let's say if I have a stock which is very thinly traded, or which is traded very less, or it's, let's say, a Z category of a stock, it is quite likely that its beta is low as compared to the peer companies. But does it mean that that's a right reflector of the risk which is being carried in the industry? Answer is no. So it is always better to see a wider set of a beta when you look at it. So usually what we try and see is the larger peer set beta or a sector specific beta, which includes multiple companies. Time frame, usually one will want to take a longer time frame rather than taking a shorter time frame. And what we have seen as a general practice is either a 3-year or a 5-year periodicity, daily, weekly, monthly. Once again, the preference is to take a weekly or a monthly. So usually the what I have seen as a practitioner is either people follow 3-year and a weekly data or 5-year and a monthly as a preferred option, rather than using a daily or using a shorter term periodicity. Also, one has to be mindful in terms of what is the level of a correlation with the market. And the reason for that is if a particular security has a very limited correlation with the market, and when the other peer companies have larger correlation with the market, then maybe because of certain stock specific issues, the particular stock has not behaved in line with the peer set. So those things also has to be taken into account. The other thing which one has to keep in mind is when you do a levering and the unlevering, in case if a particular company has a very high leverage, it is usually good to not consider those companies in the peer set, because a company which is very highly leveraged, their unlevered beta would be artificially low as compared to what would be a normal level of risk which is attached to the industry. So those are the things which you need to keep in the mind. Do a analysis, do a study of the sector and the individual companies, and look at the data set, and then take a subjective call. Interpretation of beta value. Can beta be negative? Answer is highly unlikely, but it can be negative. I mean, certain companies on certain occasions do have a negative beta, not necessarily on a perpetual level. So let's say like a defense company may have an inverse correlation with the market, because they may perform better when there is a threat on the nation or when there's a threat on the country. So while the general market might suffer, in those such situation, the defense company's stock may go up. But it is in a normal situation, a negative beta is something which is very unusual. Can a beta be zero? This will be more true for the company which has largely the cash or the very liquid security rather than anything else. Generally, what we see is basically a beta between 0.5 to 1.2 to 1.4, rather than very low or very high. Pharmaceuticals typically would have a lower beta. Utility would have a lower beta. Real estate beta would be higher. Entertainment companies beta would be higher. If I am looking at, let's say, a commercial REIT, nowadays you also have the real estate investment trust or the infrastructure investment trust. Those trusts typically have invest in the portfolio which is already commercially deployed, or it's already very largely the income generating portfolio. In those cases, beta would be lesser than one, quite sometimes significantly lesser than one. Any questions? Or I saw some. Otherwise, we can maybe take it up later. Another discussion is in terms of the company specific adjustment. Should there be a company specific adjustment? In case if there are company specific adjustments, what are the factors? What are the factors which should affect the company specific adjustment? So many a times the size of the subject company is an important factor. Customer concentration is an important factor. Is there a product or a services diversification which is there, or a company is dependent on a couple of products, or there is a limited diversification in terms of the services? Are there any project implementation or project commissioning risk? So so if a, typically a small size company will have a higher risk as compared to a large size company. A company which has a customer concentration will have a higher risk as compared to somebody who is more diversified. A company which has a wider portfolio, catering to a wider industry, will have a lesser risk as compared to a company which has a more concentration of either the product or the services. Is there a mathematical way of analyzing what would be a company specific adjustment of a 0.5% or a 1% or 3%? Answer is no. It always is a subjective assessment. It could vary from a valuer to valuer. Very important. It's very important to do the sensitivity analysis in certain cases. Sanity checks also plays a very important role, and we'll come to the sanity check separately. What is a projection risk? Now projection risk is sometimes we get the projections from the company which assumes a significant improvement in the EBITDA margin, profitability, or where you believe that the revenue growth rate is quite high as compared to what it has achieved in the past, or what the industry could achieve going forward, depending on your assessment. Certainly, a level of a discussion is required with the management of the company in terms of trying to understand the underlying rationale for the projections. Having said that, wherever there is a significant optimism in the projections, it does call for a projection risk as well, and so on. The other question which is sometimes asked is, can alpha be a negative number, or is it supposed to always be a positive number? Can I have a negative alpha? Answer is yes, I can have a negative alpha, but it is usually one has to be very careful when you do a negative alpha adjustment. So let's say somebody is doing a valuation of power generating company or a solar power generating company, which has already entered into a PPA for next 25 years. And the power plant, it is already generating power for last 2 or 3 years. And the payments are coming in time. Does it call for a negative alpha? Maybe it does call for a negative alpha. And the reason why it may call for a negative alpha is that when you look at the peer companies in the market, they'll have a portfolio of assets which will include the portfolio which is already commissioned, portfolio which is under commissioning, and portfolio where they might have bid and the expectations may be that some of those might fructify. So in those cases, the risk could be the risk of the market peer set could be higher as compared to your own subject company, which is already commissioned generation for last 2 or 3 years, already demonstrated the generations, definitive contract for 20 years or 25 years, which is almost equal to the life of the asset, limited credit risk based on the historical profile, may call for a negative alpha. But use it with it is to be used on an exceptional basis and with caution rather than as a general principle. Small example in terms of back computation. This is nothing but a CAPM model, what we had seen in the past. So if I were to look for it, start with the cost of debt, let's say the cost of debt is 12%. The effective tax rate is 25%. And when I say effective tax rate, what we are looking is basically what is an approximate tax rate which the company is paying over life of the asset. So if there are carry forward losses or if there's a tax holiday period, the effective tax rate could be lower as compared to the marginal tax rate. In those cases, the effective tax rate could be lesser than the, maybe 15% or 20% instead of 25%. So post-tax cost of debt is, let's say, 9%. risk-free rate 6.9% levered beta, let's assume that it's 1.1, it would come from the market parameters rather than something which is definitive. Equity risk premium, as I mentioned, currently many of the people, practitioners use anywhere between 7% to 8% for the India markets, gives me a cost of equity of 14.6%. Often a question is asked that should it be based on the book weights or should it be based on the market weights? And the reason for that is where you are doing a valuation of a company which is an unlisted company, you don't have a market weight available because you are doing a valuation of that company. Then how do you get the market weight in the first place? Now, my question on that is that let's say the net worth of a company is 100 crores. I'm looking, let's say, at an IT company where the net worth is 100 crores and market cap is, let's say, 500 crores. Net worth is 100 crores, market cap is 500 crores. If I am owning that company, what should be my expectation? Should I be expecting a return on the 500 crores, which is how market is valuing me? Or should I be looking at 100 crores, which is physically investment? The answer is that it has to be on the market weights basis, market weight, because that's a market's expectations. If you bought a stock of at 100 rupees, where the net asset value of the company is, let's say, 30 rupees, you will expect a return on 100 rupees and not on 30 rupees. It stems down from that. How do you get a market weight of debt? Because many a times debt is not a listed debt. In those cases, if you're looking at a normal companies, which is, let's say, not a distressed company, but having a normal operations, one can reasonably assume that the book value of a debt and the market value of debt would be similar to each other rather than being significantly variant from each other. Also, when you do the peer company analysis and you look at what is the market weight to debt to equity ratio of the peer company analysis, you are not required to find what is your own market weight. You can use the peer company analysis and arrive at a WAC, because WAC is once again a market participant WAC. I don't have to do my own analysis for my own company. So in a sense, we look at a market weight rather than the book weights. Because book weights and the market weights, there could be significant variation, especially for certain companies. So on a blended basis, in this particular examples, we have a cost of capital of 13.5% and the cost of equity of 14.6% or so. Some of the other aspect is that how do we handle the real cash flows versus nominal cash flows? What is a real cash flow and what is a nominal cash flow? Real cash flows is the one where the inflation is not taken into account. Quite often we see the companies don't forecast the inflation in the top line. Inflation in the top line in the sense that they assume that I'll continue to sell this product at this particular price going forward, and at the same point in time they assume that I'll also have a similar sort of a material cost. So let's say if I manufacture 100 units and my per unit cost is, let's say, 100 rupee, 10,000 is my top line, and I assume that 60% is my material cost, 6,000 would be your material cost. And going forward, sometimes they assume that the volumes would grow, but the sale prices will not grow. And the reason which they give is that the sale prices will not grow is that the market is so competitive that the customer will not allow me to increase the sale price. And only if there's an increase in the material cost, I'll be able to pass on only that element of the actual increase rather than making more than that. Is that argument valid? Answer is yes and answer is no, both. The reason for that is that in cases like very in cases of a competitive business pressures, that particular argument is valid. But is it valid for eternity? Maybe no. So and the reason for that, let's say if you are making 10 rupee a unit every year, does it mean that you continue to make 10 rupee a unit for after 20 years also, or should there be an inflation adjustment which should happen? So these are some of the questions which come when we analyze the projections. What is the currency of a projections? This is important when you are doing a valuation of a foreign company, or when you are doing a valuation of your company which has significant exports. Currency of projections plays an important role. Sometimes when you do the valuation of a foreign subsidiary, people convert the projections at the constant currency rate. So if, let's say the Indian company has a US subsidiary, people make the projections in constant currency, assuming that the INR USD remains at 75. If INR USD remains at 75 and he gives me a rupee projections, the question will be, is it a dollar projections or is it a rupee projections? In those kind of a situation, it may be better to do the computation in the home currency using the home discounting rate and then convert it at the current spot rate as far as the valuation is concerned. Pre-tax to post-tax rate, this is more for impairment assessment analysis, because the accounting standard does require you to do a pre-tax analysis rather than a post-tax analysis. From a practical considerations perspective, it is very difficult to compute a pre-tax cost of equity because the parameters are not visible. What is usually done in practice is that people compute the post-tax working and then eliminate the tax and try and recompute it through an iterative model or through a back solve model, that what would be an equivalent pre-tax rate, and try and assess that this is the implied pre-tax rate. But usually the computation start through a post-tax mechanism. In case of a DCF, sanity check is a very important aspect. DCF being DCF and the projections being projections, there are a lot of subjectivity which is involved. And the subjectivity is there in all the aspects of DCF. When I say all the aspects of DCF, there is subjectivity in the management projections. So if at all the cash flows has the subjectivity, there is a subjectivity in the discount rate. There is a subjectivity in the perpetuity growth rate. There is a subjectivity in terms of how do you compute the perpetuity growth rate. It can be golden growth, it can be variable growth, it can be exit multiple. So DCF is a very scientific method. DCF intuitively is an appeals to us when we think. Having said that, all the elements of DCF has a very, very high level of subjectivity. And in those cases, it has to be grounded back to see whether the DCF outcome is making sense to us as a valuer or it is not making sense to us as a valuer. And this is a important step. So when we say sanity check, it is not something that you would do just to ensure as one more step. Many a times when you do a sanity check, it requires you to go back to the drawing board and reassess the parameters which you have used, which is either the discount rate or the terminal year growth rate, or try and question once again whether the management projections are reasonable or they need to be tempered up or down. So sanity check is an essential part of any DCF. Usually you would wish to use a DCF, or if I as a valuer would not want to use DCF in isolation of the market multiple or the market approach, because while DCF gives me a flavor of future outcome or the future cash flows, market approach keeps me grounded to what is a reality. So what are the sanity checks? DCF value to EBIT, or the implied EBIT multiple, or the implied EBITDA multiple is a good sanity check. Also, from a terminal value computation, the gross terminal value, we look at what is the implied EBIT and the EBITDA multiple at the gross terminal level. What is a sustainable return on the investor capital in perpetuity? So what do we mean by this? What we mean is basically also when you do the analysis, also compute that what is a operating return on the capital, I mean the return on the operating capital employed, EBIT or the EBIT to the capital employed in the business during the projection period, how it has been there in the history. Quite often when we see the projections, we realize that the return which is expected on the invested capital is significantly higher than what the company might have earned in the past or what the peers might have earned in the past. Then we have to ask a question to us, is it a sustainable return? If the answer is no, then do we need to tone down the perpetuity computation to ensure that the return, what is going in the perpetuity, is something which is sustainable return, is something what we need to think through when we do the valuation. Before we go to a case study, any questions? And then maybe we can go to a case study. So one question which is asked is that the beta represents risk associated with the company. However, it is arrived by volatility analysis with regard to the benchmark index. In case of a recent change in the risk profile affecting the volatility, even beta of 3 year or 5 year will poorly represent the risk which is currently present. Answer is yes. In case if you believe that there is a structural change in the industry. When I say structural change in the industry is that it has significantly changed as compared to what it used to be there 3 years back or 5 years back. And those changes are so fundamental that you will not necessarily go back to those times going ahead. In which case, maybe a shorter term volatility may be more appropriate. Or even in those cases, if a shorter term volatility, if you believe that it is not fully capturing the underlying risk, maybe sometimes you also try and assess some sort of a company specific risk premium. So if I were to go into it in a bit of a detail, let's say if I'm looking at a telecom company valuation, and let's say if I do a Bharti Airtel valuation, does a 5 year beta making sense at this point in time? Maybe yes, maybe no. The reason is basically because of, let's say, the coming of Jio around 2 years back or 2.5 years back, the industry itself has fundamentally changed in terms of the risk and the return. And a 5 year profile, will it underestimate the underlying risk? Maybe yes, right? In those kind of a situation where there is a sector specific structural change which might have happened, you may wish to look at maybe a shorter term volatility, or alternatively do some sort of a company specific or a sector specific adjustment. I mean, that's how typically one can think on this. Meme method for intangible asset valuation, how to compute the contributory asset charge. Benchmarking risk-free return and adding an asset-specific risk premium will do. If yes, risk premium more based on the assumption or must be based on market inputs. So while meme in DCF are slightly different, but let's say if I were to answer how to compute the contributory asset charges, what are contributory assets? So maybe for a wider participants. What is a meme method? Meme method is the multi-period excess earning method. typically used for valuation of an intangible asset. This is what we usually use for a purchase price allocation when we do the valuation. And to what kind of an intangible we do the MIM valuation. If I were to slightly step back, what is a business? Business is nothing but an amalgam of tangible assets and the intangible assets. Tangible assets could be the fixed assets of the company. It could be the working capital of the company. Intangible assets could be the brand. It could be the technology. It could be the customer relationship. It could be the workforce of the company, and so on. So do we assign, do we need to do the valuation using MIM for each of the intangible asset? Answer is no. One does the valuation adopting MIM for the intangible assets, which is the most significant of the intangible assets among the category. So let's say if I'm doing a valuation of a pharmaceutical company, OTC product, over there, maybe the brand would typically play a most important role as compared to anything else. And how do you do the MIM? What is a MIM? MIM essentially is like a super profit. So you start with value. You start with what are the profits which the company is expected to earn. In case if or my particular brand product is expected to earn, from that, whatever is the cost or the contributory asset charge, typically what we call in the valuation parlance, for all the assets. So if a business uses the working capital, you have to reduce the contributory asset charge. If a business uses the fixed asset, you have to reduce the contributory asset charge. If a business uses the technology, you have to reduce the contributory asset charge. And then whatever is the residual amount is something which is attributable to the subject intangible asset. This is the MIM in short. From benchmarking the returns, typically we see what is the capital structure generally prevalent in the industry. So if I'm computing the MIM for, let's say, a fixed assets, typically I will assume, a funding of 50-50 or so between debt to equity, or sometimes 60-40, 60 for debt, 40 for equity. If I'm doing a working capital, I will usually do 70-30 or somewhere around 70-30. The element, what should be the 60% and the 40%, that is something which you anyway have arrived when you do the WACC computation. So you know your borrowing cost, you know your post-tax borrowing cost, you also know your post-tax equity based on the CAPM model, and try and align that. Having said that, once you do that, it is also important to ensure that when you do the weighted average return on assets, which is for all the assets put together, how closely or how far it is vis-a-vis the two other numbers, cost of capital and the IRR, they should be reasonably close to each other. And if reasonably close would be, let's say, something like 0.5% delta or 75 bps of delta should be okay by and large. And that's how you would do the assessment. Between the intangible assets, if certain intangible assets have a higher risk, qualitatively you'll give it a higher risk. The goodwill will be the highest of the lot. Risk premium to be based on assumptions or market-based inputs. While market-based inputs are something which are preferred, in this kind of an asset, you will not have a market-based inputs because they are rarely traded on an independent basis. And even if they are traded on an independent basis, it is very difficult for you to estimate what is the market's expectation in relation to those assets. So more often than not, these are based on the assumptions rather than the market inputs. The initial inputs, which are like the computation for WACC and the cost of equity, would be based on the market assessment or the market inputs. But the adjustments would more often than not be subjective on a qualitative parameters. For IT services industry, share valuation of non-IT industries, share valuation of an unlisted company, how can we derive a perpetual growth and a beta? Let's say if an IT services company And I assume that for IT services company, you are looking at something like a BPO or a KPO equivalent. There are many of the BPO, KPO companies which are listed on the market. You look at their volatility, you look at their beta in the historically. As I said, typically, we usually look at a 5-year monthly beta. People also see 3-year weekly beta, but between these two, one computes what is the beta of those companies. Perpetuity growth rate. So what is the perpetuity growth rate? Should it be 4%? Should it be 5%? Should it be 10%? And the reason for 4-5% is nothing but the inflationary expectation, or by and large, a long-term inflationary expectation. Reason for 7-9% is nothing but a real growth rate. So when I say that the India is growing by, let's say, 4%, 5%, or India is expected to grow by 4%, 5% in a medium to long term, this 4-5% are nothing but a real growth. So in nominal terms, it will grow by something like 8%, 9%. Should I use 8% or 9%, or should I use 4% or 5%? Typically, as a practitioner, what we use is something close to 4% or 5% rather than 8% or 9%. And the reason for that is, do we assume that the company would continue to earn a super normal return for an indefinite period? Is something which is slightly hard for us as a valuer to assume. More often than not, we use something between 4% to 5%. Having got the answer, essential to compute the implied EBIT, DCF to EBIT multiple, DCF to EBITDA multiple, and see vis-a-vis the peer companies whether it is making sense or not. Can you explain the step to be taken into consideration for valuation of a small company? How to value a partnership or an LLP, and steps to be taken for such valuation, which method to adopt, what will be the impact of recent change in income tax relating to the goodwill? Can you explain the step relating to the consideration for valuation of a small company? For a small company, the thought is that the underlying the risks is higher. When I say the risk is higher, is the growth rates could be higher because a company which is smaller can grow faster. Having said that, it can also disappear faster, or it can also vanish faster as compared to a larger company. So essentially, it's a risk adjustment, or it's a discount rate adjustment rather than anything else. Should it be 0.5%? Should it be 5%? Should it be 3%? Difficult call. At a global level, you have a Duff & Phelps size premium study which is available, but those are largely focusing on the US market, and it does give you a category wise adjustment for this small risk, small entity, I mean the small size entity, as compared to a large size entity. We at this point in time don't have any similar studies focusing on the India market. So in India, we still go with the judgment. If the projections don't have a significant optimism, or if these projections don't have a significant aggression per se, and if the management quality is, so in small company, it is very essential to see what's the quality of a management, because the quality of a management is something it's basically nothing but a foundation for any growth, any small company. So quality of a management, quality of promoters are something which are, while they are subjective assessment, but they strongly influence your assessment of the incremental risk which you would wish to put on top of as an alpha person. If I were to make a simplistic assumption that the company is reasonably good, profitable company while it is a small company, the good promoters, then maybe some sort of a 2%, 3% may be more appropriate. Many a times we do a valuation of a startup. For a startup, CAPM would fail because your discount rate expectation will start from anywhere between 25%, 30%, 35%, 40%. Then it is hard to come to a similar discount rate through a CAPM model. So those would be more based on the market assessment. And you have certain studies which are available more for the US market, what would be a private equity return expectations, which guides those sort of a discount rate. How do you value the partnership firm or the LLP and steps taken for such valuation? Partnership firm or an LLP, once again, you would try and do a valuation in a manner which is similar to a corporate per se. One thing has to be kept in mind is that the capital structure, you have to see that there is there a significant amount of a capital which is getting infused, or is there a significant, is there a withdrawal which is happening? So just be careful around that particular aspect. But otherwise, from a business valuation perspective, it would be similar to what typically you would do for a normal valuation. If there is any significant change in the capital structure, you have to be cognizant of those changes. What will be the effect of a recent change in the income tax relating to goodwill? Should it affect the valuation of the business per se, or this is more in terms of a transfer of a business? And I would think that from a business valuation, there should not be any implication. If at all there are implications, they'll be more from a transaction structuring and what would happen in case if a partner is retiring and those things per se. I'll take this as the last question, and then maybe we'll do a small case study and come back to this if that's okay. Market approach versus income approach. Suppose a valuer chooses CCM with 100% weight and uses DCF for reconciliation for value. There is a huge divergence, maybe due to the market irrationality. For this, any change is required in value arrived through CCM. Now this is a tricky question. Are we here as a valuer to judge whether the market is irrational? Or we say that market is nothing but a consensus expectation of a multiple participants. Do I as a valuer put myself into the shoes and whether I decide whether this stock is worth investing? Or as a valuer, am I an investor or am I a valuer? If I am a valuer and I'm wearing a hat of a valuer, you need to have very, very strong reason to assume that the market is irrational. Can market overreact? Yes, market do overreact. So if I were to look at, let's say, the disruption in the market, which was there maybe on the 31st of March last year because of COVID, maybe the market has overreacted. But does it mean that the market prices are fundamentally wrong at that point in time? Maybe no. You need to have very, very strong reason to believe that the market is irrational. And especially over a longer period of time, as a valuer, one would not want to assume that the market is irrational over a longer period of time. If there's a very significant variation, you need to go back to the drawing board and see what is the reason for such a deviation. I'll take a small case study. We'll just quickly run through it. I think most of you would have been familiar with DCF, would very easily understand it. And I'll also share the Excel spreadsheet post the presentation. So we want to do a DCF of a company, and these are the numbers which are available. Revenue of 9,000 million on day zero, which is basically the historical year, let's say FY 2021, and growing beyond, including the EBITDA margin and so on. Capital expenses of 100 million going up to 500 million. Working capital as 30 days of revenue, which is basically the assumption which has been given to us. This is the day zero balance sheet. that the net worth is 6,750 million, borrowing is 3,000 million, fixed assets 9,000 million, and the operating working capital 750 million. No surplus asset, no surplus liabilities. Some sort of a contingent liabilities, including the probability of materialization of those contingent liabilities. And the valuation parameters. Valuation parameters in terms of the risk-free rate, equity risk premium, levered beta, debt equity, borrowing cost, tax rate. Additional information in terms of the top five clients contribute 60% of revenue. We need to then think through, do we need to do any adjustment from a CSRP perspective or from an alpha perspective. And perpetuity growth beyond 5 years, maybe assumed at 5 years. So this is broadly the case study we want to attempt. And we'll go to the Excel. Is it visible? Okay. So what I have done over here is that I already, so let's first go to the WACC computation. The risk free rate is 8%, equity risk premium is 7%, levered beta 0.9. Debt equity market weights and debt equity book weights, borrowing cost is 12%. Now, from a computation perspective, the risk-free rate, equity risk premium, levered beta is 0.9. 14.3 is nothing but 8, which is the risk-free rate, plus beta into equity risk premium, which gives me a base cost of equity of 14.3%. I have assumed the company-specific risk premium of 1%. Since the top five clients contribute 60% of revenue. This remains a subjective assessment. What we do in reality is we also do a sensitivity analysis at what sort of a discount rate, how the values are changing. So if the WACC is not 13.5%, but if let's say 13%, what is the change in the overall value? To get a sense of the impact of the company specific adjustment. So it's an iteration. It's not something which you do and you forget about it, but it's an iteration. You having assumed a certain thing, when you do the sensitivity analysis, you may want to revisit the number as well. And what is the analysis which you will do? Let's say it's an automotive company, auto ancillary company. In case of an auto ancillary company catering to a OEM client, is 60% warranting a company specific risk premium? Answer probably may be no. So if I'm an auto ancillary company catering to a, let's say an OEM or the original equipment manufacturer like Honda or like Toyota or Hyundai, I mean, those three or five players would make the market at large. In such a situation, you may not have a warrant, it may not warrant for any incremental company specific risk premium. But let's say if I'm an IT company, in an IT company, if a top five clients are contributing 60% of the top 60% of the revenue, it can certainly warrant an equity risk. I mean, it can certainly warrant a company specific risk premium. In those kind of a situation, when you have significant customer concentration, it is also good to see that which are those customers and how long they have stayed with you in the past. In terms of, is there any significant movement coming in or going out? I mean, was it 75% last year and it has gone down to 60% because of somebody significantly reducing his contribution? So those sort of an analysis is required when there are any specific aspects for which you want to do a company specific adjustment. cost of debt of 12%, which is given, 30% of tax rate for the time being, we assume that this is akin to an effective tax rate rather than a marginal tax rate. We come to a post-tax cost of debt of 8.4%. Going back to our earlier discussion, should it be market weights or the book weights? Answer certainly is that it has to be market weights. Giving a market weights of 80% to the equity and 20% to the borrowing, we come to a 13.90 of a weighted average cost of capital. When we do a valuation, we also see if I were to make it 2%, it will go to 14.7. If I was to make it 0%, it will go to 13.1. These two numbers, I'll keep it at the back of my mind, and I'll do a sanity check or I'll do a sensitivity analysis when I do my DCF computation. So this is basically on the cost of equity computation. CSRP we discussed, market weights we discussed. Am I audible?
Yes, sir, you're audible.
Okay. Sorry, some problem with connectivity. I'll just share this.
Yes, sir, you can proceed. Thank you, sir.
Is the screen visible?
Yes, sir.
Okay.
Yes, sir.
So we were on the computation of the free cash flow to form. We start with the EBITDA. This assumes that the projections has been discussed and we are by and large comfortable with the projections. Adjust for the depreciation. Simplicity, this is akin to a book depreciation, tax depreciation. Otherwise, the tax computation will have to be done separately. So this is book depreciation coming to the book EBIT. Perpetuity, we are assuming a 5% terminal growth rate. We do the same thing for depreciation and we come to a similar EBIT number. Tax computation in reality is a full-fledged computation that you start with your taxable EBIT. If there are any carry forward losses, you adjust your carry forward losses. If there is any tax holiday period, you enjoy those tax holiday period and do the computation. Over here, for the time being, we have directly taken it at 30% of the EBIT. In reality, it's a full-fledged computation. Adding back the depreciation since it's a non-cash item, reducing the capex which has been provided to us for terminal year capex and depreciation are usually assumed to be equal rather than under significant variance to each other. The reason for this is depreciation in the longer term is nothing but the reflection of what is a wear and tear of the equipment rather than something which is an accounting charge. In reality, it is an economic charge. It is not an accounting charge, but it's an economic charge because it is nothing but a wear and tear in the equipment or a reduction in the worth of the equipment which I'm using it. And in the perpetuity, that depreciation has to result in the incremental cash outflow because I'll have to replenish those capex. Does it mean that in the sixth year I'll have to replace it? Not necessarily. But overall, if I'm looking at a perpetuity as a single number or a single column, more often than not, we would use depreciation and the capex as an equal number rather than a significantly a different number. Very, very exceptionally, and if you have a very, very strong reason, you can use a different number. But more often than not, we'll use a similar number. What are the instances where we may end up using a different number? One example which comes to my mind is, let's say, something like a transmission asset. Transmission asset is basically a transmission tower which has a life of, let's say, something like a 40 years or 35 years or 40 years. But they are basically a very, very hard assets and they go for a longer period. In those kind of a situation, you may want to deviate slightly, but otherwise, depreciation and capex to be done equal. One thing which is often missed out by the valuer is the change in the working capital how do you compute the working capital requirement for the terminal year. Working capital requirement for the terminal year can be significantly different as working capital requirement for the horizon period. Because what I'm assuming is a tapering down of the growth. So when my incremental working capital was 127 million in the fifth year, my incremental working capital in the terminal year is significantly lesser. And why is that the case? We'll go into the computation of how it's typically done. So over here, we have been given that the working capital is 30 days of revenue is the assumption what one can use it. So when the growth is higher, the working capital requirement is higher. And the incremental working capital requirement is higher. And when the growth tapers down from 20% to 15% to 10% to 5%, the working capital requirement reduces rather than increasing. So many a times what we see is that the valuer miss out this particular aspect and they take it as a working capital change over the previous year, like what we did for the EBITDA. But that would be an incorrect computation. It has to take into fact that your projected growth is significantly lower as compared to the historical growth. So this is what we get as a free cash flow to firm, which is the post-tax EBIT, adding back depreciation, reducing the capital expenditure, and reducing the working capital item. Usually, from a valuation perspective, we do a mid-year factor, which is like assuming that the cash flows accrue evenly throughout the year, rather than at the end of the period. So this is basically 0 to 1 and 1 to 2 and so on. For the fifth year, it will be 4.5. So cash flows will accrue between 4 to 5 years. PV factor based on the 13.9%. 13.9 is what WACC we have computed. This assume 1% CSRP. And as I said, we'll go back to into 1% CSRP merit or otherwise. Coming to a PV of FCFF. So when we do the overall computation, 5825 is nothing but it's a PV of FCFF for the horizon period. How do we compute the terminal value? We saw this computation. It is significantly lower as compared to the immediately previous year because of the fact that the depreciation and the capex are assumed to be equal and partially offset by working capital reduction rather than increase. Reduction in the sense of relative term. 13.9 is the WACC. 5% is the perpetuity growth rate. So what you are basically doing a capitalization is WACC minus perpetuity growth, which is 8.9%. Gross terminal value is 1288, which is the free cash flow for the perpetuity year. This is the 1 year after that, divided by 8.9%. And when you do a present value factor is the what we are using it the last year, which is 4.5. It is not 5, it is 4.5, because if you were to do a mathematical computation, you'll realize it. Sometimes people use, for perpetuity computation, people use the fifth year discounting rate rather than 4.5. But if you're using a mid-year convention, what is mathematically right is to use a 4.5 year instead of a fifth year. And present value of terminal value is nothing but the gross terminal value into present value factor coming to those number. 13882 becomes the gross enterprise or the business enterprise value. Are there any borrowings which are there on my balance sheet? Answer is yes. I have a 3000 million of a borrowing which is there on my balance sheet, which I need to reduce when I do the valuation of the company. Are there any contingent liabilities? Answer is yes. There were some adjustment which we need to do for the contingent liability. So the probability of materialization was given in those cases. If there is any tax break which is expected because of the materialization of contingent liability, it has to be adjusted. So if there are claims which are not acknowledged as debt, and if they materialize, I will be able to claim tax break, I'll make an adjustment for that number. Income tax demand will not give me any tax break. So there is no tax break available. And so this is a gross adjustment for the contingent liability. Coming to the equity value of 1044. So this is typically a sample DCF computation. As I said, sanity check is very important. So when we look at the implied EV EBITDA multiple, it is currently coming to 11 for the historical number, 11 times the immediately previous year profit and 9.3 times the next year profit. Are these reasonable? Are these not reasonable? One has to go back to the market multiples and get a sense of it. So what do I do with this? This is not the end of it. This is the starting point of it, that once I get the implied EV EBITDA multiple, I go to my peer set and I try and see, is this multiple looking reasonable or not? Are the peer company trading at 7 times multiple, 6 times multiple? Then maybe I need to revisit some of the assumptions. Are the peer companies on an average trading at 15 times EBITDA multiple? Then maybe once again, I need to go back to the assumptions. We also should do a sensitivity analysis in terms of what is an implication on the enterprise value for change in the key parameters, which is typically the WACC and the growth rate. One can also do a similar analysis for change in the revenue growth rate or change in the EBITDA margin. So if the EBITDA margin is not what is projected, but it goes down by 1% or goes down by 2%, what is the implication? Similar sensitivity analysis can be done. From our perspective, if I were to look at it, what would we do with this? We had said that when I do a WACC analysis, I need to get a sense of what is this adjustment and how much I'm destroying the overall value. So if this is 0.5%, my WACC goes down by around 40 basis points. So, and if it is 0%, my WACC is 13.1%. So effectively by applying up 1% CSRP, what is an adjustment which I have done to the enterprise value? I have reduced enterprise value by almost 10%, 11%, because without any CSRP, the WACC would have been somewhere close to 13.1%. With a WACC of CSRP, it is coming to 10,044. So by 1% CSRP, my enterprise value has declined by 11%, 12%. This, then you have to reassess whether the risk which is there in terms of the customer concentration, does it warrant such sort of an adjustment? Should it be higher? Should it be lower? Right? As I said, it's a qualitative call, but you need to do this assessment to figure out whether your judgment is appropriate or otherwise. I think this is broadly from a case study perspective. And maybe we can take up any residual questions before we close for the day. Yeah, both the presentation and the worksheet shall be shared. I'll share it with Anjali, and maybe then in turn she can circulate to all the participants. Any questions or any further questions? So I think Anjali is having some problem with the audio. I mean, any other questions from your side? I mean, happy to address them.
Hello. Sir, I'm audible now.
Yeah, it's audible. It's echoing a lot.
Now it is fine.
Yeah, it's now fine. It's now.
I'm really sorry for the technical glitch. My heartfelt gratitude on behalf of Ahmedabad branch. We are heartily thankful to our distinct faculty, CA Ravishu Shah. Your prompt acceptance for the session shows your commitment and passion to contribute to the profession. Sir, your in-depth knowledge, thoroughness and expertise and the command you have over the subject covering this difficult topic, almost all the aspects of this topic is incredible. I'm really glad and thankful to CA Bhakti Shah for introducing you, and we look forward to meet you, see you at Ahmedabad branch once the things are normal. And lastly, I would be thanking all the knowledgeable participants for making it possible. And we would love to have suggestions and feedback from all of you. Thank you so much. And once again, I'm thankful to you, sir. It was really an excellent session.
Thank you. Thank you very much to all the participants and the organizers. And it was a pleasure to have a session with you all. Thank you very much. Thank you.
Thank you, and wish you all a great evening. Thank you, sir.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.